My yes. best friend is named Jette. Of course, it's endless confusion.
Jette?
Yeah.
With honey.
Yeah.
Oh, Jette.
Okay. Jette or Jette is like Ming and Jing. It's the racist joke.
No, no. I'm going to sit.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Wilson Center. Good to have you here. Thank you for joining us. I'm Andrew Seeley, Executive Vice President of the Wilson Center. Our President and CEO, Jane Harman, wishes she could be here today. This is actually a topic very close to her heart and that she has written and spoken a great deal about, but she is out of the country actually today. She's actually across the Atlantic giving a talk. So I have the honor, however, of being here in her place and welcoming you here. We are truly value our relationship with His Excellency Martin de Hinden. Thank you, Ambassador, for being here. Ambassador of Switzerland to the United States, worked very closely for a number of years. And Dr. Andreas Kellerhals, Director of the Europa Institut. Andreas, good to have you here. Back again. You will hear from both of them shortly. We work closely together to promote serious discussion on transatlantic issues for the last 3 years at least together. The fight against violent extremism has become one of the defining issues of the early 21st century. Attacks in Brussels, Paris, Jakarta, Baghdad, Copenhagen, Dhaka, Bamako, and Orlando remind us that this threat is not just regional, but global. Our goal today is to help set the framework for how government, civil society, and the private sector can work together to develop best practices to strengthen communities against extremist agendas and to better coordinate international efforts. This is no small task. But you have a panel here that has all worked very extensively on this issue and can shed some light on how we go about doing this. I would like to recognize both the Swiss Embassy in Washington, D.C. and the Europa Institut at the University of Zurich, our partners in putting together today's event. And I want to thank Mike Van Dusen, who I think really originally made the connection, the center's former executive vice president, who really put together the connection that started this event. And Dr. Christian Osterman. Christian is somewhere over here who oversees our Global Europe program and his team that made the event possible today. And I also saw Emily Buss somewhere, who I know worked on the beginnings. Emily, there you are, worked with our Global Europe program, and glad to have you back here at the Wilson Center. This is our third annual Swiss Day, part of our ongoing partnership with the Europa Institut, which also brings 2 to 3 Swiss scholars to the Wilson Center annually. We've had some fabulous scholars over the years, and we're grateful for your ongoing support and partnership. And now, Ambassador de Hinden, you're a longtime friend of the Wilson Center, and I'm thrilled to welcome you back. Appointed ambassador to the United States in 2014, Ambassador Hinden has also served as the director of the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation and as the head of the Directorate of Corporate Management of the Swiss Federal Department of Foreign Affairs, to just name a few of his many postings and accomplishments. And somewhere along the way, he got a PhD in economics as well. It's my honor to welcome His Excellency Martin de Hinden to the podium. Ambassador.
So, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, I would like to welcome you at the third annual Swiss Day at the Wilson Center. We are discussing about kind of a global challenge, a challenge in terms of developing the right strategies and having the right responses, something that needs concerted action. Switzerland is actively involved in fighting violent extremism. We look at it as a multi-layered, complex, unpredictable issue where we need a response that can cope with this complexity. As international cooperation is essential, we very much act under the framework of the United Nations Global Counterterrorism Strategy. And the 3 points I want to make now are related to that strategy. The first is about military and law enforcement issues. This is one of the responses that was very much in the center of the debate. To disrupt terrorist attacks by military means, by law enforcement means. Switzerland does not have a tradition of or the capability to take intrusive military actions beyond its own borders. However, in our own territory, we do the utmost that it is not misused, that our infrastructure is not misused by terrorist groups. Secondly, it's about disrupting the flows that sustain terrorist activities, flows of weapons, flows of fighters, flows of finance, and flows of information. With our significant role in banking, in finance issues, we have a particular responsibility to curb and to interrupt flows of finance. And thirdly, and this is very much today's focus, thirdly, we focus very much on the root causes of violent extremism, which starts at the local level, is linked very much with social, familial, educational issues in affected community. And it starts sometimes within the confines of our own borders. The U.S. has raised this issue of countering violent extremism to the top of the international agenda, together with civil society leaders, of course, with other governments, with people from leaders from the business community. I'm deeply convinced that in the long run, we will only be successful against violent extremism when we are tackling the root causes. And this is something I'm very much excited to hear and learn more about this afternoon. Thank you for your attention.
Mr. Ambassador, ladies and gentlemen, as it was said, it's the third time that we are going to organize this Swiss Day here in Washington, D.C. We started it some years ago, and it is a project that is supported by the Swiss government. And I can just learned a few days ago that the funding is available for another 4 years. So we are very much looking forward to this further cooperation. The idea of the Swiss Day, as we call it here, it was always that we can bring Swiss issues somehow, or issues that are of interest to Switzerland, at least for half a day here to the Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington, D.C. We bring scholars and experts from Switzerland and discuss issue of mutual interest. So we started first with security mainly in Europe. And then last time we had the role of central banks in times of financial crisis. And now today we talk about fighting cooperation in fighting extremism over the Atlantic. we just talked this morning, Christian and I, maybe also we have the idea to expand maybe this cooperation we have. So far, it's the Swiss Day once a year here in Washington. Then we can send every year two scholars from Switzerland, for each of them for 4 months here to the center. They do study, they do publishing, they do also speaking events. And the idea is that we could do more of that, that we might be able to invite scholars, members from the Wilson Center to come over to Zurich once a day, a year, and the same for Swiss people to come over here and to have this exchange of ideas. It's the notion of sister republics is somewhere in the room, and right now in crisis like this, or in times like this, we should strengthen this cooperation between Europe, maybe Switzerland especially, and the United States. So we are proud on this cooperation and very much looking forward to continue in the near future. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Khaled, you're up to bat. I believe I'm Mike Van Dusen, and I just want to say to give the maximize the time for our various panelists that have an awful lot to say on this subject. that you have a copy out there of all their bios, and I'm not going to get into that now. Thank you.
Great. Thanks very, very much indeed. Let me thank Ambassador de Hinden, Professor Kellerhausen, and of course Vice President Seely for inviting me to come here today and to kick off what I hope will be a really fruitful discussion both amongst you and amongst our expert panel. Let me also congratulate you on having the foresight to identify a really important topic. Just yesterday, the Global Terrorism Index was published, and that Global Terrorism Index demonstrates that the numbers of people killed by or affected directly by terrorism is increasing. It shows that the number of countries where people are being affected is increasing. It shows that the economic costs of terrorism are increasing, up to $90 billion lost last year to the global economy directly as a result of terrorism. And of course, it identifies important new challenges in this field, and I know that Ambassador Hussey will speak about this, such as the return of foreign fighters from places such as Syria and Iraq. So I think this is an immensely topical issue and an immensely important moment to be discussing it. I have the honor and the pleasure to be the executive director of something called the Global Community Engagement and Resilience Fund. I don't want to use this platform to spend too much time talking about GCERF, the Global Community Engagement and Resilience Fund, but I will spend just a couple of minutes telling you about the fund and what it's about, because it's so closely allied both to the Swiss and to the US, and I think presents a nice example of how these two countries have really coalesced and come together and converged around this important agenda of preventing or countering violent extremism, PVE, CVE. But what I really want to do is, after a few words on GCERF, really put out some comments and some statements and perhaps provoke discussion to hear from our expert panelists and see if we can get some answers from them and from you. Very quickly then, an introduction to GCERF, and of course I hope you can all visit our website and find out much more about us, www.gcerf.org. GCERF is a multilateral funding mechanism intended to provide funds to support local community efforts to prevent violent extremism. Very briefly, three conceptual underpinnings for the formation of GCERF about 2 years ago, and again really led by the Swiss and the US governments. The first conceptual underpinning, that indigenous knowledge, local knowledge, is more important with respect than think tanks, governments, universities, and I'm a former think tanker, so I can say that. If you want to understand the local context, if you want to understand why people are making the seemingly incredible decision to join Boko Haram, to follow radical agendas, let's speak to the mothers and the clerics and the sports coaches and the people working in the communities, and let's hear what they have to say. I think that's one important conceptual underpinning. The second part of the concept for establishing GCERF was that there may be great initiatives at the local level, but there is a funding gap. Local communities lack the funding and the resources and the capacity to launch the initiatives that they know better than us will work. And I think through our 2 years' work at GCERF, we've demonstrated that that is true, and there really is a funding gap at the local level around these issues of preventing violent extremism. And the third conceptual underpinning for GCERF was that the best way to fill that funding gap is by establishing a multilateral funding mechanism, a mechanism that can do more than any country bilaterally can do alone, a multilateral funding mechanism that provides access to local communities that perhaps can't be easily accessed by bilateral donors. A mechanism that has greater reach than any single donor. A mechanism that allows you to leverage your input into a blended fund and realize a much wider impact. A mechanism that develops technical expertise and promotes learning. All sorts of reasons why it was thought that a multilateral funding mechanism like GCERF would be the right way to fill the funding gap. We spent the last 2 years piloting this model, testing the concept, and I think the proof of concept is there, and I think we've demonstrated that people such as Ambassador Hussey, who really set up GCERF, were right, that there is a funding gap and that a multilateral funding mechanism is the best way to fill it. We have launched hundreds of projects at the moment in three countries, Bangladesh, Mali, and Nigeria, to the value of about $15 million so far. Very briefly, the projects that we are funding fall into three broad categories. One category is about raising awareness of violent extremism. So, for example, working with clerics and imams in mosques in Mali to help them understand what the warning signs are. What do you do? What are the warning signs when people in your flock, in your community, appear to be becoming radicalized? A whole series of projects around raising awareness. A second series of projects about mobilizing action. For example, in Nigeria, providing a safe space for women in communities to come together and to talk about their concerns. Often their voices aren't heard. Often they feel threatened at making bold statements. Often they're ashamed or frightened to say things about what's happening in their family. Let's find safe spaces so that they can mobilize for action. And the third broad category of projects that we're funding at the moment really are about creating alternatives. Because what we found again and again and again is that if you can create constructive alternatives, most people will choose those rather than the radicalization path. So this is about income generation, about working with getting children back into the education system, about small grants and loans, about entrepreneurship training, and so on and so forth. And finally, on GCERF next steps, we are expanding quickly into Kenya, Kosovo, and Myanmar. I suspect also Tunisia next year. Of course, the whole range of challenges around monitoring and evaluation, further fundraising, results, impact, a whole list of challenges ahead of us that I'm happy to answer if you wish. No more on GCERF. What I'd like to do instead is to pick up just two themes, different themes, that I think GCERF represents, and then focus in for a moment on those two themes. The first theme is that GCERF deliberately and explicitly is about prevention. GCERF, I think, is one of the only organizations in the world today focusing explicitly on preventing violent extremism, PVE. That is an agenda that I think many people in this city now think may be under threat. And I think I'd like to say a few words about that. The second point I'd like to make about GCERF, and I think this really resonates very clearly with why we're here and the two countries that are hosting this event, is that GCERF really is about a Swiss-US alliance. GCERF has 13 donors, 12 governments plus the European Union, but really our strongest champions were Switzerland and the United States. These were the two really foundational governments that set GCERF up. And again, it's a nice example of how these two countries converged around the PVE agenda through expressed through GCERF. The question I'd like to put to the panelists and to you is this. How can transatlantic dialogue, and I think we're here to discuss transatlantic dialogue, and perhaps even more specifically, Ambassador Hinden, how can Swiss-US dialogue make sure that we maintain the appropriate focus on this PVE agenda? Again, many people, I think that the agenda may now be under threat or jeopardized. The backdrop for this question, I think, is as follows. It is quite clear that over the last 2 years, the United States has been in the lead of developing the Preventing Violent Extremism agenda. Much of the thought leadership came from this city, Washington, D.C. Much of the institutional work, including the establishment of GCERF, came with funding and support from this city, Washington, D.C. Best practice has emerged from Washington, D.C. in this field. Most importantly, as you know, President Obama hosted two very major summits last year on this theme of preventing violent extremism. So the U.S., I think, has led in terms of institutions, thought leadership, and very high-level summitry on really getting the PVE agenda on the international horizon, and I think has done so very successfully. What's equally clear to me, and this is just on the basis of having spent a few days in Washington, speaking to people from government, speaking to foundations, speaking to civil society, some colleagues from the private sector too, is a concern that there may be a realignment of US interests away from the PVE agenda, given what happened last week in your election. All I'd like to do is this. I don't think we should be crystal ball gazing. I think no one in this room and no one perhaps in the city knows what's going to happen next and who's going to fill which role in the administration and so on and so forth. But I do think it behoves us, and I think there's a role here for the Swiss government, to reinforce the case for whoever is coming into the administration that PVE is important. And so let me just spend a couple of minutes sketching out what I think that case is. And again, I look forward to learning from the expert panelists and from you. This is just some sketch ideas. I think we need to make the case, the why, the what, the who, the where, the when of preventing violent extremism, and really remind ourselves and reinforce both in this country and in other countries the importance of maintaining this agenda. If there's any lesson to learn from Brexit, if there's any lesson to learn from last week, it's that you shouldn't take anything for granted. And I think we shouldn't take anything for granted, and we really should be reinforcing and thinking about the case for maintaining a focus on preventing violent extremism. So firstly, the why. I can think of at least three reasons, and there are many more, but at least three reasons why maintaining a strong focus on preventing violent extremism is immensely important both for this country and for the world more generally. One is, and I think we have to be careful playing this card too forcefully, one is national security. And that's certainly a concept and a term that I think resonates with many governments, understandably. One of the implications and findings of the Global Terrorism Index that I spoke about at the beginning of this brief presentation was that there's been an enormous rise in terrorist attacks in OECD countries, in rich countries. This is clearly no longer a challenge of the poor world. It's also clearly a challenge of the rich world. There's a direct threat to national security emerging, I think, from the growth in terrorism and violent extremism. The GTI, the Global Terrorism Index, I think also makes very clear that there are growing intersections between violent extremism, terrorist groups, and criminality and cybercrime. I think that's another area that we must be focusing on when we think about this national security argument. There is also an argument, and we must make it immensely carefully, and I have a colleague in the audience who I'm sure will say more about this. Let's make it carefully, but there's clearly also a link between violent extremism and migration and refugee flows. But please note what I'm saying. I'm not saying that migrants and refugees are coming to commit violent extremist outrages. I'm saying that they are fleeing violent extremism. And there's certainly one of the reasons why we have a spike in migration and refugee flows in places like Europe is the growth in violent extremism. We have to work through the correlations. The second reason I think that you can make a strong case that we must maintain the focus on prevention, on preventing violent extremism, is, and I think we should be honest, and I think we're here in a think tank community, in a think tank setting, I think we should be honest and clear that counterterrorism alone doesn't work. I think the lesson of the last 15 years that we just heard put on the table for us is that counterterrorism measures are expensive, ineffective, and often full of unintended consequences. I'm a dual national from the UK and Pakistan, and I can assure you that some of the radicalization we have seen in Pakistan has been a direct consequence of our counterterrorism measures. Counterterrorism is important. You have to do something when you find terrorists, but counterterrorism alone cannot work. And I think that case can be made very strongly indeed. The third case that I would make if I was trying to establish this case for an incoming administration is that PVE is actually immensely cost effective. This is a relatively small amount of money surgically, incisively put at an early stage in vulnerable communities to focus on intervention that I think can make a huge difference, especially since we recognize that the focus for violent extremism, preventing violent extremism, is about empowering local communities. So I think this is remarkably cost-effective way to deal with what otherwise will become a long-term challenge. That's the why, and again, I think this case needs to be made forcefully and elaborated much more than I'm doing at the moment. What about the what? What should a response to preventing violent extremism look like? What have we learned in the last 2 years at GCERF and the last 5 years since this has been on the agenda? Well, one thing we've learned is that there's a funding gap, that there is no natural source of funding for preventing violent extremism. Some of the money comes from security sector sources, but most of that is spent on hard security counterterrorism responses with relatively little money left over for the sorts of softer security stuff that we're talking about, women's empowerment, access to education, critical thinking, so on and so forth. Some of the money comes from development pots, and certainly the OECD DAC has recognized that PVE is eligible for ODA. GCERF has been recognized as an ODA eligible organization, which means that you can report contributions that focus on PVE and that come to GCERF against your official development assistance targets. But still, and I think I referred to Pakistan, there is still immense suspicion amongst many colleagues in the development world about this agenda. They see it as a security-driven agenda, they see it as a US agenda, they see it as a State Department agenda, and they see it as risking hijacking development principles. So one of the challenges, I think, for any incoming administration here or elsewhere is to address the funding gap for preventing violent extremism, because I think it's quite significant at the moment. A second thing that we've learnt is local communities. The real focus of this work needs to be on local communities, which is immensely difficult. The drivers of violent extremism are contextual, are locally specific, change over time. We're talking about behavioural change, working with local communities to build new resilience against violent extremism. These are very difficult areas in which to demonstrate quick wins, easy results, easy impact. There's all sorts of challenges around working with local communities, but that's, I think, where the focus should be. The third thing we've learned, and I think this is very important, is focusing on the responsibilities of national governments. This mustn't be seen as another Western campaign. This mustn't be seen as some form of imperialism. This is about working with national governments to understand their particular challenges and help them develop their own national action plans to deal with their challenges. So the role and responsibility of national governments, absolutely important. The who? Well, I think there's a couple of answers to the who should be responsible for this work. Firstly, I think we need a whole of government approach. I think this is an opportunity to overcome some of the inefficiencies that we've seen around preventing violent extremism. The silos that are developed between the diplomatic community, the defense community, the development community. Let's take this opportunity in the name of cost effectiveness to make sure that we are cost effective and we bring together the right sorts of people and the right sorts of funding sources to really launch new funding around this area. Secondly, clearly, while civil society is important and I think increasingly engaged in this field, I would like to focus on and emphasize the role of the private sector. I think there's an enormous role. It's difficult to do, and I can tell you more about what we're doing about it, but the role of the private sector in really helping to promote and take this challenge forward, platforms, challenge funds, putting money on the table, social media, extractive industries that are particularly concerned. There's all sorts of ways I think the private sector is important. And thirdly, in terms of the who, I think we must recognize that this is about global partnerships. No single country alone can achieve what it wants to achieve. You have to cooperate, you have to collaborate. And there are international partnerships from the Global Counterterrorism Forum, of course, to the United Nations as well. A couple final points from me. Where? I'm going through this very quick reinforced action plan for PVE. Well, it's clear there has to be a global focus. Now, that will make a lot of people run away because that will make people think they have to be active in 200 countries. That's not true. I think we just need to be smart. We have the metrics. We have the Global Terrorism Index. We know where the vulnerable communities and countries are. Let's respond to the data and make sure we're working in the right places at the right time. Secondly, we have to recognize this is a transnational challenge. Anything that you do in one country has consequences in other countries. We have to recognize the interrelationship between actions in one country at one country and consequences in other countries. And a third point I'd make is that we really need to focus on specific localities. I think we need much more work about, for example, preventing violent extremism in cities. I think we have to be careful about it, there has to be more work on preventing violent extremism in some refugee camps around the world, for example. So local specificities are important. And the final one of my why, what, who, where is when. And this is the answer that I have. This is about prevention. This is a long-term goal. You can't achieve prevention with 1 year of funding or with 1 year of attention. You need long-term commitment to the prevention agenda. And I think we must make sure that we make the case that that long-term commitment is important and is there. It has to be sustainable. I think sustainability is an enormously important principle. And thirdly, of course, the answer to the question when is now. Because it's quite clear, if you look at the Global Terrorism Index, for example, that our opponents are not waiting. This action has to take place now. And to share one of my concerns around the Preventing Violent Extremism agenda, I am nervous that it will slip down the path that, for example, the migration and refugee agenda did, which is lots of dialogue, lots of summits, lots of international meetings, and not enough action. Let's make sure that we're action-oriented as quickly as possible. My final comment, I think, again, we have to make a clear case that maintaining a focus on the prevention is important, that preventing violent extremism is in the national interest of all countries, whichever color, whichever administration around the world today. But to make the case convincingly, and here I think we'll hear from the experts around the table, to make the case convincingly, we need to do three things. Firstly, we need to define the problem. And I still don't think we have properly defined the problem. What is violent extremism? What is driving violent extremism? Secondly, we need the data and the evidence to show what works and what doesn't work. This is a risky enterprise. We're funding local communities. We're supporting people who haven't previously received money or launched initiatives. We have to recognize what works, what doesn't work, and provide the analytics, I think, as quickly as possible. And finally, let's learn and let's fail fast and recover and start again. We have to recognize that this is an area where we're sharing risk, where we're taking opportunities, and I think to learn from those and to fail fast is very important. So my final comment is simply to return to the Global Community Engagement and Resilience Fund and to say that I look forward to continuing to work with the very strong alliance between the Swiss government and the US government in the years to come.
Thank you, Khaled. That was a wonderful opener. Hutta Clausen.
So I actually will do the professorial thing and have some slides with data. It is... no secret that there has been a great deal of pushback against the CVE or PVE agenda, countering violent extremism or preventing violent extremism, particularly from Muslim communities in Europe, in Britain, where there has been 10 years of experience with CVE or the prevent agenda. What do I need to do to get a slide up? Do I need to do something? The real issue with the CVE agenda from the viewpoint of many Muslims has been that Muslims become stigmatized. Now, data and data-driven policy has been very important for many reasons, one particular reason being that it actually can help us avoid stigmatizing Islam or stigmatize Muslims as a risk group as such. All right, so thank you. Thank you. The reality is that there is really no population marker that can actually identify who is at risk for becoming a jihadist terrorist. I invite you to participate in a thought experiment to drive home that point. Let's say that we have, since 9/11, had 300 American homegrown Muslim terrorists, and ignore for the minute that some one-third are converts to Islam. And let's say that there are 3 million Muslims in this country. That leaves us with a probable risk factor estimate of 0.0001, a number that is so low that going from the category American Muslim to the category jihadist terrorist is, from a public health perspective, completely impossible. There are simply no population markers. Put differently, it means that of the base population of American Muslims, at most, and again I'm ignoring the converts in this picture, 1 in 10,000 American Muslim has become a jihadist terrorist, as defined by the law and either convicted in American court, or gone abroad to do something, participate, fighting with ISIL, et cetera. Now, at that rate, it is not possible to approach this issue from a public health perspective. This is one of the reactions to the fear of stigmatizing Muslims has been to actually widen the agenda and talk about other types of violent extremism, talk about risk factors far more broadly. But I would argue that that's actually not the right way of going about the problem, because we do need to recognize that jihadist violent extremism, it has a far higher lethality rate than any other types of violent extremism. The other aspects that we need to recognize is that this is an ideology that endorses massive civilian casualties as its real objective in when carrying out attacks. So we are dealing with a very, very tricky problem. And having a data-driven approach is required in part to drive home the point that terrorism is a marginal problem, but it's a very serious problem. And it's a serious problem because the jihadists are more dangerous. They actually stigmatize Muslims by putting forward a version of Islam that has nothing to do with how Muslims live and practice Islam, but are using it as a revolutionary ideology in the name of Islam. And we have seen the consequences here in this country in proposals that aim to basically pull up the bridge and, as our president-elect Trump has said, not allow any more Muslims to come into the country. That will have zero effect in terms of increasing domestic security and protection against homegrown terrorism. So I have been funded by the Department of Justice's National Institute of Justice now to do research for some years on who to provide some data. And here's one set of data. So I'll show you three different data points, and we can talk about. And this is all about work that I have research I've done on American Al Qaeda inspired terrorism offenders. Now, one of the first, I've already talked about one of the misconceptions, namely that it somehow has anything to do with Islam or with Muslims. The other misconception is that it's usually young people. In fact, this is a political crime, and it is usually adult men. So here is an age profile, the estimated age of offenders at the first indication of radicalization. When people actually radicalize requires very detailed forensic work on the biographies of the offenders. But doing that, I created timelines and traced when people, at what age people typically who then went on to become a terrorism offender actually had become radicalized. And you can see that very few conform to the picture of the 14 and 16 year old or 18 year old. About two-thirds of the American terrorism offenders are actually men between the ages of 19 and 20 and 29. There are also older offenders, but these are adult men. That has enormous consequences for our ability to carry forward preventive intervention. Most of these people radicalized at an age where we don't typically have very many institutional levels for reaching them, for identifying them, for actually having an intervention program. In United Kingdom, there has been a very important shift in the what's called the Prevent Agenda Contest. It's the program called Contest, which focuses on identifying very young people as being at risk. That is probably not the way to go. The efficiency of these programs has not been studied. There's really no way actually to effectively assess the efficiency. Another point I wish to make is, if we can get this forward, is that it is often said among the Westerners that they are pushed to become terrorists from discrimination, from socioeconomic exclusion. But in fact, many are quite well educated. One of the things that I tested was to see if dropping out of school or out of job started before people became radicalized or after. The social exclusion argument would have that people are pushed out of society and then become extremist. Now, what this big bar shows here is that most of the American offenders actually radicalized before they dropped out of university or college. Many, we have a good number of college, we even have people with advanced degrees. Now, the question is, to what extent these types of results can be extended to other countries, and maybe Lorenzo, who knows a great deal about this, will address that. But it is not uncommon, for instance, one of my graduate students have done work on Tunisia, and it's pretty clear that you also have a very, on average, people who become jihadist terrorists actually are probably better educated than the general population. And this is probably a result that is not unique for the West. So that raises questions about what are the motivational factors that drive people to embrace a violent extremism. And increasingly, the emerging consensus is that it's actually perverse altruism, a desire for action. It's simply the excitement for, in some cases, of actually taking violent action, being in charge, and all of these factors are very different from, it's a very different discussion than the one we have had previously about the causes of terrorism. If I can make it work, the last one here is that one of the things that is often said is on the part of law enforcement, particularly in this country, but also in Western Europe, is that There simply are no behavioral markers. We have no time to intervene. It is not possible to, in any realistic fashion, to figure out who is going to be a problem. And this was addressed. Khalid talked about education of bystanders, of mosques and imams, so they can pinpoint what are the behavioral cues that will reliably inform us who we should be afraid of, who we should worry about, where we should intervene. Now, so one of the things I did in my work was that I looked at these biographies and I charted the timeline from when people from their biographies were clearly committed to extremism and when they started to make plans to do something criminal. And what I found was, breaking this down by different demographic groups, was very, very different patterns by groups. So one interesting fact you will note up here is that since 2010, the moment from initial embrace of the belief system to actually taking action leading to criminal, to arrest or death, has declined dramatically. And this is a result that I know my colleagues at George Washington University has used different methodology but also confirmed. Likewise, START at Maryland has also seen that we have in fact been watching a dramatic acceleration on average in the radicalization process. Now, the question is why? Is it the internet? Many people have blamed the internet. Or is it instead simply the fact that the Islamic State has practiced an open door policy, literally allowing anybody who wanted to join to come to join because they needed to populate the new state. They needed to populate the caliphate. So they were willing to take teenage girls. They were willing to take people who had no previous training, even knew how to pick up a gun or use it. And then of course there's the issue with Turkey having allowed pretty much anybody who turned up at the bus station in Istanbul to move on and meet with the recruiters and move on to the Islamic State. Now that is now over. So structurally speaking, what are we gonna see going forward? Well, we have seen a bunch of things, and there are a number of things that we already know. And that is that we have seen a diffusion of this particularly extremist ideology across to many, many countries that have not previously had experience with this type of violent extremism. We have seen a dramatic increase. There are probably 10 times as many armed and ready and trained extremists loose in the general Mediterranean area and elsewhere today than there have been before. And it is a global phenomenon. It is global in the sense it's global, but it's also local. And historically and traditionally, Western countries respond to challenges nation by nation. And the first instinct, as we have seen in the presidential election, is to draw up the bridge and think that you can handle the problem on your own. Well, you can't. Today, anybody can meet a jihadist from wherever they are. All 50 American states have ongoing investigations or have had incidents. I recently spoke at the International Association of Chiefs of Police at their annual meeting. And the point there was that if you have not already had an encounter with this phenomenon, you will have it. And that is what we can say structurally speaking going forward, is there is Switzerland was protected, did not experience this phenomenon until sometime in the last 5 years. It has become a significant issue. But even countries like Finland, Latin America is now on the risk list. So we are looking at a very, very different phenomenon today than we were just 5 years ago. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Huda. It says on her bio that she's here at the center as a fellow this year and writing a book on this subject, and we're very happy to have her here. Lorenzo.
Can we shut this down?
Yes.
Distract people.
Yeah, I'm not going to use the PowerPoint. I do the Italian PowerPoint, which is just excessive hand gestures. So I'm going to be. It's a much easier, probably less professional, but much easier thing. but I will try to be, in honor, I think, of the Swiss embassy that invited me here, and it's a real pleasure. Thank you. I'll try to be not Italian in bed and try to be punctual in my remarks, try to be living to 10 minutes. And it was indeed the 3 years I spent in Switzerland until 2014 were very interesting because I started to see the beginning of a debate about the introduction of counter-radicalization strategy in Switzerland, the debate about the beginning of the phenomenon also in Switzerland. And to some degree, although the two countries are very different, finding some of the same problems in implementing a CV strategy in Switzerland and the US. Federal system, I know there's a lot of similarities there. And that have always been one thing that has sort of prevented both countries from really implementing some somewhat of a strategy domestically. I will get to that in a second. I said I wasn't going to be professorial like Jutta with the PowerPoint. I will be in a sense that I will do another very professorial thing, which is outlining a lot of the problems and not giving many solutions. I think Khalid was great in outlining some of those. I literally cannot agree more with every single thing you said about the need of continuing the PVE agenda and how you articulated that in a very, let's say, balanced way. And I would tend to agree with that, so there's no point in me really delving into that. But I think both of you in your presentations touched upon a huge difficulty in implementing a PVE agenda, which is understanding the radicalization process, understanding why people radicalize. And at the end of the day, if we need to do something, if we need to invest resources, we need to really understand that we are investing in right, that we are doing something that tackles the problem. And I think the studies that we have seen here, I think everybody knows, it's become quite well known that there's no such a thing as a common radicalization trajectory, that radicalization is a highly complex and individualized process with huge differences in how people radicalize, in their socioeconomic background, in a variety of, in how the mobilization takes place, in the age. I think every single factor that you look at, you're going to find huge differences in special effects. I didn't have the PowerPoint. I compensate with that. And I think that is something that we have seen throughout. I remember being in Switzerland when there was talk about introducing a prevention strategy in Switzerland around 2013, 2014. I know the debate has become much more active over the last few months. And then one of the first cases came up in Switzerland of one of the first foreign fighters to come back. And he turned out to be the son of a very prominent professor at the University of Lausanne, ethnic Swiss background, very affluent family. So nothing of a lot of the problems that normally I would say most of people would see as trigger factors as to why people radicalize. And I think that's a very common dynamic everywhere. It has been a debate, I think, that has the relationship between integration and radicalization that oftentimes, obviously not for people like Jutta or for people who really study the issue, but at the level of media coverage or so on, or sometimes with shallow political debates, you get that almost mathematic equation, lack of integration equals radicalization. And then when we really get to the issue, you see that it's almost the opposite at some times. It's really paradoxically counterintuitive at times. And I think I can point to many different points, data points, that will show that. If you look, for example, from a European perspective, which countries have seen the highest levels of radicalization, those are actually the countries that fare better when it comes to integration. Countries like my native Italy or Spain, which are really not great places when it comes to integration. There's a reason why all migrants or refugees try to move north in Europe. They want to go to Sweden, they want to go to the UK, they want to go to Germany. I don't blame them, they're completely right in using just Italy and Greece as entry points. But yet, if you crunch the numbers, the number of foreign fighters we have seen, Italy has produced 100 foreign fighters and only 16 with Italian passport. You go to much smaller countries like the Scandinavian ones, and you have to double or triple those numbers. You go across the border to Austria, which is a country that invests a lot of resources in integration, and again, fares much better than Italy on all the data points you would use to judge integration. They have around 350 foreign fighters. So why Italy would be an exception, maybe we're not very good at counting, but I think it's deeper than that, and it goes to a lot of other dynamics. Which show then, since we're here to talk about CV, how difficult it is to create these measures, and to some degree some of the mistakes we make, and of course this is very context specific. One of the comments that Khalid made that I couldn't agree more with is that everything we're talking about when it comes to radicalization is context specific. A program in Mali, will have nothing to do with a program in Sweden. The reasons why people radicalize, the socioeconomic conditions are completely different, and it makes little sense at times to transport. There are some common factors, of course, but it's very, very context specific to the point of being city or neighborhood specific, not let alone not area specific. But if there is one common factor is that we are talking about individuals and not communities when it comes to the West. We don't see communities radicalize. The numbers, again, I'm terrible with numbers, but I think you show that statistically, the number of, even though we have seen a spike in numbers of radicalization over the last few years, we're still talking about a statistically significant number of people who radicalize, which makes some of the CVE programs that we have seen in the West to some degree more difficult to justify. And again, some of the things that make sense in Pakistan or Mali or Somalia are perfectly fine there. What I'm saying is that they might make less sense in the West. Some of the programs that we have seen, for example, in the first incarnations of Prevent, some of the more social engineering programs, they were probably somewhat ineffective. Or maybe they're very useful programs that favor integration and so on. Nobody's here to argue that integration is not a good thing. But they're not necessarily well delivered if they fall under the counter-radicalization umbrella. So, and probably cops and spooks are not the best people who are there to deliver any kind of program that builds swimming pools or does interfaith dialogue. So integration is obviously very important, but A, it's not the main factor, as this was not a clear connection between lack of integration and radicalization, and B, we are to improve integration, let's keep it separate from the counter-radicalization agenda. So we're talking about individuals, and we're talking about individuals with very different, very heterogeneous profiles. I think some of the programs that we have seen more results, and here's the one point I'm going to slightly disagree with Jutta, to be academic and be slightly provocative, otherwise it's not part of what I'm being called here for, is that some of the programs that we have seen do have, to some degree, a proven track record of results. It is not great, it is not the most scientific of track records, but since the goal here, and I think you close with the point of saying we got to show that some of the stuff that we have been doing is effective, I think some of the more laser-focused, tailored programs have shown a relatively high degree of success. Now, for some of the other programs, it's extremely difficult. Maybe some programs are very effective, but it's kind of like advertising. You have to prove that people bought a car because of your commercial. Might be a great commercial, but very few people run into a car dealership saying, I bought the car because of the commercial on TV. And here is even worse, because you have to prove a negative. You have to prove that people did not radicalize because of your prevention campaign, your counter-narrative, your counter-messaging campaign, which is highly difficult. That doesn't mean that needs to be done, but it's obviously highly difficult. I think where one has an easier case to make for where effectiveness resides is in the more one-on-one targeted interventions, where certain individuals, and again, I'm talking mostly about the West, where individuals who are, whether at the very beginning of the radicalization trajectory or at the very end, like returning foreign fighters of that trajectory, are identified, and obviously in the case where criminal action, for one reason or the other, it's not considered to be the best way forward or is not possible, variety of reasons, having approaches where a mentor, somebody, to some degree, makes some sense into that person and tries to sway that individual away from the ideology, away from that mindset. And I think we have seen some results, for example, everybody, go back to Denmark, in Aarhus, the program in Aarhus, which has seen, again, it's something that obviously needs to be assessed in the long term, but at least for the time being, I think it's fair to call a relative success when of the 30, 35 individuals that have gone from the city of Aarhus to Syria and gone back to Denmark and have been treated through this very relatively sophisticated program that the city of Aarhus has put together, basically only a handful, it's debatable, but only a handful have gone back to militancy. So it's a relatively high success rate. Even Channel, the part of the Prevent program, but has received a lot of criticism that basically does the same thing, intervening on specific individuals who are undergoing the radicalization process, has suffered a lot of criticism, a lot of it is justified, but according to the British government, and again, one needs independent verification, so all the caveats of the case, has seen a 60% success rate. Now, you can, you know, fudge with the numbers. You know, you obviously, they tend to take people at the very beginning of the radicalization process. If you would take the people at the very end, that 60% would probably go down to 6%. It's undeniable. Nonetheless, CV is mostly about threat reduction rather than threat elimination. So if you have, let's say 60% is an inflated number, you have a 40% success rate. That allows law enforcement to focus much better to allocate the limited resources that they have on the harder cases, those on which it's basically impossible to do preventive work. Obviously, the approaches are not easy because the I'm looking at you for time. Whenever I'm overstepping, the Italian side comes out. Obviously, because the profiles are so difficult, so different. I'm sorry. It is obviously something that one needs to do in a very tailored way. In some cases, it probably better a very religious-based approach. For other people, religion has nothing to do with the reason why they're radicalized, and it might be something of that has to do with mental issues. In some other cases, it might be a relative, the best person who is qualified. Former radicals have been proven to be relatively successful. Little self-promotion here. At the center I run at GW, we have hired a former Al-Qaeda propagandist who has obviously reformed after seven, just I think it was a necessary caveat, obviously. And after I served his time in prison. And since he's been released from prison a year and a half ago, has been doing a variety of activities that aim at preventing radicalization and de-radicalized individuals. It's something that has never really been done when it comes to jihadist extremism in the US, but it's very common in the UK and in other countries, and obviously, the power that somebody that was part of a certain group that understood not only just the radicalization process, but in that specific case, the recruitment process, because he was a recruiter, is somebody who could be potentially very effective. Now, some people will listen to him because he's charismatic. Some people will not give him the time of the day. Nothing will work all the time. What works for case A will not work for case B. But I think there are some proven records, and if we're here to make the case, I think we have to look at those experiences. What I think, I don't want to politicize it, but obviously we all have the results of last week elections in mind. The criticism for CVE, and I'm going to close with that, the criticism for the PVE agenda comes from sort of all parts of the political spectrum. It comes from the left, it comes from the right for different reasons. I'm going to focus for obvious reasons more on the right. And it has often come, aside from those that think there's an inherent problem with Islam and Islam is problematic per se, so there is that component which I don't even know how to address. But there are parts of the right that are criticized traditionally, the preventive agenda, which arguably it's a soft tool, it's sort of a bit of a hippie kumbaya approach to it, which is something that is highly disproven by the fact that the very first proponents of the CVE agenda are law enforcement intelligence agencies. It is something that paradoxically sometimes had the opposition of components of civil society, of the people who are would be more on the kumbaya hippie side of life, and those that, with exceptions of course, but for the most part are the most vocal proponents of CVE are the tough guys, are law enforcement and the spooks. And I think that's telling, and that's probably a case to be made, and having both voices be the one delivering some message to those who are more bent on the hard part of the counterterrorism strategy. I'll leave it at that.
Thank you, Lorenzo. That was very, very good. I was told this microphone was responsible for that noise you heard. Ambassador Stefan Hussi of Switzerland, and thank you very much for being here. Your turn.
Thank you. So when I took up my current position in March 2014, the GCERF was already as an idea on the table, so I cannot take the credit for that. I think it was a really transatlantic commitment and even a personal commitment between State Secretary Kerry and Federal Counselor Burkhalter. And at that time, CVE was not really an issue in the international debate. And by the way, the fund is called the Community Engagement and Resilience Fund. I think that was maybe a wise decision, because the labeling approach can be quite tricky, because everyone will wonder who is the violent extremist. So, you know, that's this exactly this stigmatization approach, which could be, which can be counterproductive. So it was on the table, and Switzerland had the presidency of the OSCE, and we put terrorism on the agenda, and very much supported by the US. And we organized a conference in April 2014, and on the agenda was the legality principle. That's always an important issue. The rule of law, the human rights, respecting human rights while countering terrorism. There was the kidnapping for ransom, because at that time there was an important issue. And the foreign fighters, they were called foreign fighters in the OSCE at that time, and not foreign terrorist fighters. And there was even a discussion if this should be put on the agenda, and it was, this was end of 2013, it was Russia that put it on the agenda, which is quite remarkable. This was before the Ukrainian crisis, so I don't know if they had put it on the agenda in spring 2014, but it was there. So, others were not really, they were not sure if this is such an important topic. And this was in April 2014. And then all the developments. In May, there was an attack in the Jewish Museum in Brussels. And it was a man, Menouche, who was in Syria for 1 year and returned back and committed this this crime. And then the rise of ISIL, the take of Mosul, and then it came like a wake-up call. And then I started to become a global problem, because people, governments realized that from many countries, in particular Jews, left for joining ISIL in Syria and Iraq. This was really, governments started to mobilize, and in Switzerland as well. If you look at the figures, from 2001 to 2013, it was about 20 so-called jihadist travelers who left for different places, Afghanistan, Somalia, and Syria and Iraq. From May 2013 to May 2014, it doubled, 40. And from May 2014 to this year, it doubled again, roughly, another 40 or 35 who left. So it was really taken, the governments were taken by surprise by these developments. And we know that now it's about 100 countries of origin. And that's the global issue. Why? And this is not foreigners. It's youths. It's residents, Swiss and residents in Switzerland who left. It's our youths who left. What happened? What happened to them? That came up, this question. And that was then really, let's say, the start of developments, conceptual developments, political developments, in particular led by the US and the Security Council. Like after 9/11, it was the Security Council that took the lead. And in September 2014, the Resolution 2178 was adopted on foreign terrorist fighters. And this Security Council resolution contains quite remarkable language on countering violent extremism, about social cohesion, about inclusion, about empowerment of women, about empowerment of religious leaders, all these issues in a Security Council resolution, which is, it's not under Chapter 7, this part, but still, which is a clear guidance for member states to pay attention to these issues. And then President Obama invited for the summit, the CV summit, and the White House summit process was extremely important in just designing the response, the work strands for CV. And then in 2015, it was handed over to the UN, and the Secretary General developed an action plan, a PV action plan, which is again an excellent document, because it's not new. Addressing the root causes is not new. It's even in the 2006 global strategy, UN strategy. It's the first pillar, and respecting the human rights is the fourth pillar, but it was not implemented. So this was really a push, this process, this White House process, which led to this UN action plan, which was again really supported by the US and by Switzerland. We have an excellent cooperation with the State Department on these issues. And now the recommendation is to have national action plans. I think that's extremely important recommendation, because I think on an international level, the train has left the station. Whatever will happen in the supporters, with the supporters, but it's there, it's on the agenda, it's on the international agenda. But at the same time, it is, and that's one of the shortcomings, or some say it's one of the shortcomings, there is no definition in this global action plan. What is violent extremism? Is it the same as terrorism? There is no global definition on terrorism either. So we say it's a global problem, yes, but we don't know exactly what we are talking about. And which means that this, to translate it into a national action plan, or to develop a national action plan, including the definition of the problem, because how do you want to address the problem if you don't know what is really at stake? So that's extremely important recommendation. And in a way, what Khalid and GCERF is doing, he is funding grassroots projects without having these national frameworks. So he has to do at the same time, or at least coach the government and all the other stakeholders in developing these national frameworks. And that's something which is Switzerland supporting through the GCERF, but not only, because Swiss Development Corporation has a track record in working in fragile situations, for example. And with Ambassador Martin Dahinden, he really took the lead on this. It's a reorientation towards such situations, which are breeding grounds for violent extremism and terrorism. So I think that was the reason why in Swiss foreign policy, we had an action plan before we have a national action plan, because we are now developing the national action plan. And there, I think there is a lot of similarities with the US, because we are a federalist system as well. And if you look at, and again, if we talk about preventing violent extremism, it is really work upstream, because once the threshold of a criminal offense is transcended, then it's another scenario. It's the law enforcement agencies that take over. Although you cannot, it may be in parallel, this continues, the preventing violent extremism. Just to take these statistics, the youth. So if you have a youth who is in conflict with the law, you have the juvenile justice system that should come in. And there, of course, you have a lot of educational restorative approaches, which is important to prevent recidivism. So it's not that, you know, you have these different stages, but still, we are talking about upstream, and we are talking about non-coercive measures. And if you look at the sectors, education, integration, relationship with religious organizations, even the penal system, this is all cantonal. Even public security in Switzerland is cantonal. It's just the prosecution of terrorist acts, which is federal. So setting up such a plan requires really a cooperation between all the levels, the federal one, the state level, but the cities as well, because we are confronted with an urban problem. While maybe FARC terrorism in Colombia, this was in the jungle, today we are talking about a modern phenomenon. It's very cosmopolitan if you look at some of the drivers. You have the internet, you have the travels, the globalization. So cities play an extremely important role in preventing this kind of violence. So we are doing that, and then you have the whole civil society actors, the religious organizations, and so on. So this is extremely challenging, and the maybe the risk now is that after, because there was a big backlog as well in law enforcement, I can tell you in 2014, I was quite surprised to see there were databases in Europe, and there was some information exchange, but Interpol notices were still exchanged by fax. So you could not take the attachment and compare with other databases. So much has happened on that level. There is much more exchange of information, much more police cooperation, much more mutual assistance in criminal cases. This has improved. And the risk now is that we stop here and we do not allocate the resources for the prevention part. And that's on an international level. So I think GCERF is a good example. There is difficulties to raise the resources, but on a national level as well, you have to allocate these resources. And these are long-term policies and activities. It will take years, and it's not easy to monitor the results because these developments are so complex, it's extremely difficult. What plays a key role is the research. We need much more research that is done now, and the research you have to zoom in on the local level. What is happening in Molenbeek is different from another district in Brussels. So to say, it's not only from one country to the other, it's sometimes from one district to another district. So we need much more research, but I'm quite positive because we have projects like GCERF, and there is action research as well. It's really monitored, and we have much more research. We have the concepts, but we have to continue really our engagement. And I think there the transatlantic partnership will be extremely important because at the core, for example, is human rights. This reference. Rule of law, fight against corruption, because it's if you can say you need justice and jobs, then you have already solved a lot of the problems of the drivers. So you need all that, and so I'm really looking forward to this ongoing cooperation with between Switzerland and the US on these topics. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stefan. I want to open it up to the floor. For questions, Khaled, I wanted to give you an opportunity if you had any comment you want to make, but maybe weave it in an answer to a question. There are microphones on both sides, and I ask you to identify yourself and a short question. Anybody like to ask a question? Yes. Take the microphone.
I'm Peter Humphrey. I'm an analyst and a broadcaster and a former diplomat. One thing you said is that this is very case-specific depending on the region and the area, and I don't necessarily buy that because there is a very, very strong common thread. When you read the Daesh's propaganda, they're quoting certain phrases from the Quran, and they're in there. It's not a question of interpretation. It's pretty clear what those phrases say. And we're up against a problem where the book itself has some pretty bad stuff in there. And we have to sort of wing that problem. We have to persuade Islam writ large that there are certain phrases which may have belonged back at that time but should be overlooked. And at the same time, we need Muslims to quote the other phrases in the book which countermand those phrases. And that type of analysis is never done by secular people like you. I mean, you really have to hire, you know, imams and middle-of-the-road Islamic ulema to conquer that problem, because without a black pen removing those 100 sentences from the Quran, you're going to be stuck with this problem forever.
I'm happy to talk about it.
Yeah, me too.
What?
So, we actually really think that religion is terribly important as a motivating factor.
You blew it. It is.
How do you know that? What if, what if, what if?
Brief the guys who went to Syria.
I have a question.
Well, wait. There's a thread here. Unless, is it right on this point?
Would I be allowed to answer?
So, I am a lawyer here, and I was going to ask Khalid that you mentioned that your project started with three countries, Bangladesh, Mali, and Nigeria. Can you be more specific of what's going on in those countries?
Sorry, we'll get to that. Finish your train of thought, and anybody else who wants to comment on the first question, then we'll get to that.
So most of the people who become jihadists do not come from religious families. They actually have very little religious education. As is the example with the converts, they embrace a revolutionary ideology at the same time as they convert to Islam. I'm not saying that that Islam isn't a structuring factor in this belief system. It is. But this is not really about Islam per se causing people to become extremists. The most, I think, most powerful argument against your viewpoint is that very often one of the first things that these people do when they become radicalized is that they go to the nearest mosque and start berating the imam. And actually, that's one of the most important signs or behavioral indicators of radicalization, that somebody turns up and starts yelling at the imam, as it happened in a mosque near me in Boston. Tamil and Sanaev turned up and caused a ruckus in a local mosque by complaining that the imam was praying for Martin Luther King. And observing Martin Luther King's Day. This is a war within Islam. It is not about Islam that's causing it, and I think we seriously will never get this right if we keep harping about the question about a text in the Quran.
Just to say, of course, this is that there is much discussion and research on that, and there is, for example, now in Switzerland, when it comes to certain imams, they are testing out the limits of the law. What is incitement to join ISIL, and what is falls under just religious freedom? So, and that's one of the, you know, the religious leaders. The role of the religious leaders is one of the action plan and training of these religious leaders, because the problem is that they are sent from Saudi Arabia, for example, trained there, and without knowing the context in Switzerland, they are preaching, and that's a problem. So we have now investigations, criminal investigations against such preachers, imams. So that's drawing the line between incitement and religious teaching, which is not incitement. But of course, I fully share this view that targeting communities in general, religious communities, is a recipe for failure, because it's always individuals within communities that are radicalizing. And I think that's so you need really a very targeted approach towards individuals in order to succeed in the long term.
I think both Jordan and Morocco have fairly extended, expansive programs to train imams to go to many, many countries, and they've been training hundreds of them. Did either of the two of you want to comment on this? Then why don't we go to the second question about what you're doing in Bangladesh, Mali, and Nigeria, if you mentioned it before, but yep. The lawyer there would like to know.
Sure, of course, and I can send you infographics that show you in more detail. I mean, I think I spoke too quickly, perhaps, in my presentation, but a whole range of projects largely falling in three categories. One is about raising awareness of violent extremism. One is about trying to mobilize action against violent extremism. And the third, and I think the most important, is about creating alternatives, constructive alternatives, jobs, so on and so forth. So, you know, hundreds of projects largely categorized in that way.
Are there other questions out there? Yes, the lady here.
Hi, my name is... Hi, my name is Filiz Odabas-Geldi. I am with the International Association for Human Values. I think one question that kept coming up is why people are radicalized. And there seems to be an agreement that it's a highly complex process. But perhaps there are some areas that we can all agree on, like lack of opportunities, poverty, lack of employment, frustration, extreme stress. These are some underlying factors. And these issues, like dealing with poverty and lack of opportunities, is not something so easy that we can solve overnight. So perhaps shifting the attention to the individuals who are dealing with these realities makes more sense. And obviously, addressing the psychosocial factors have become more and more in attention lately. But I want to ask Khalid, for example, you mentioned three countries. I'm just wondering if you are considering other countries to...
They're adding three more this coming year.
All right. And whether you are open to working with organizations that have programs, tools, and techniques that are highly researched and evidence-based to address exactly how to shift mindsets, how to transform individuals so that they respond better to their situations. Thank you.
Thanks. Yes, again, my English accent and my speed of speech, I apologize. Bangladesh, Mali, Nigeria this year, Kenya, Kosovo, Myanmar next year, possibly Tunisia as well. So we're trying to expand. And absolutely, I mean, GCERF is a fund, and so my main job is to raise money and to spend money. But almost as a side effect, GCERF is generating an enormous amount of data. And I think we have to think about how to partner up with think tanks or universities or experts to make sure that we really share the knowledge that we are learning from at a local level. So, I mean, absolutely, we're a partnership organization, so we will partner at all levels.
The lady in the third row. And then the gentleman in the first row.
Thank you. My name is Leila Heiss, and I work at Muflehun. We're launching a new program imminently called REMPOF, which is a helpline for families and friends of people who they think might mobilize to a violent extremism. And what we're seeing right now is there's some kind of a gray zone in terms of the laws for intervention. For instance, like what is incitement you were mentioning to terrorism support, like aiding and abetting. What if people have not committed a crime yet, about, you know, reporting laws, who does that apply to, families or not? So lots of questions, so we're really navigating in a gray zone. So I was wondering if you could maybe talk about what measures should be taken, what clarifications would be needed in the legal framework to help us intervene more effectively and have more clarity. Thank you.
Who would like to tackle any of that? Lorenzo?
Sure. I think you you're right that I think the U.S. in that lags a bit behind. And I think I know a lot of people on the panel have praised the U.S. for being at the forefront of CV, and I think internationally that's very true. I think domestically the U.S. lags behind very much when it comes to developing a strategy for a variety of reasons, some of them quite justified. But one of the problems is exactly that there's no intervention strategy. And whenever community organizations like yours, what I'm familiar with, or others want to do something, or just isolated individuals, yeah, many cases of imams or people in one way or the other want to act, they're very concerned that they might actually end up in trouble themselves. So because you start talking to somebody that is radicalizing, is being watched by the FBI, and your support, your conversations might be misconstrued into being material support. I think that's a concern that you hear very frequently. In other countries, I think there have been very clear guidelines. Obviously, then, whenever you draft a law, then it's interpretation of it that gets tricky. At the same time, there are clear guidelines. For example, the exceptions to the confidentiality that exists between mental health professionals and patients. There are, again, every country is different, but you would have often exceptions. And basically, what's happening in a few countries is that the same exceptions do apply in cases of radicalization. Without any kind of regulation the way it is in the US, I think it's very problematic for community organizations to step in. It has been no surprise that some of the programs that the FBI has been doing, like the shared responsibility, SRC, the sort of shared responsibility council committees, that the FBI has put together and then dismantled recently, it's one of the concerns is that it's the lack of clear legal guidelines.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Tom Davey, retired Navy commander and consultant here in DC. And two quick questions. You talk about the importance of jobs to reduce the prevalence of terrorism, and at the same time, a lot of the terrorists are in fact very well educated people who could get a job anywhere. So I'm not quite sure the correlation. And second, ma'am, on your definition of terrorist, I think it was way too high of a bar. It's the kind of thing you would perhaps have to prove in court. My definition of terrorism would be much more lower. And not only people who are actual, honest to goodness, kill someone terrorists, but also the people that support them and enhance the environment. You were talking about the imams in Switzerland who were coming this close and testing the limits.
In response to your question, my definition of who is a terrorist, I'm a researcher, I have to have permission to do the research I do. I have to follow certain guidelines for research with human subjects, and I can only do this using public records, which is why my research is based on public records, meaning that I am looking at people who have been convicted of terrorism offenses. I cannot walk out and point to somebody and say, you might be a terrorist, right? It's not for me to decide. I would not be allowed to do that research by my university. So I agree that when it comes to questions such as who actually really we should be concerned about, it is clearly the case that there are some recruiters that can be very difficult to identify by these means. And actually, there are ways you can, one of the issues Khalid brought up was that we often, one of the research techniques that we use is actually to do mapping of hometowns where people come from, and it's very not in this country because this problem is still a bit thin on the ground, although we have clusters in Northern Virginia. But it is the case that there is a very complex relationship between offline and online groups, but it is, we are talking about a politically motivated violent extremism, which means that this is a political act and these are political groups, and politics is group-based. So while it is individuals who join, then they tend immediately to create cells around themselves, groups around themselves. I think the conflict that you identified between what Khalid is working on and what I'm working on is that I'm working on Westerners and I'm not in Mali or in Kenya. So we have very different drivers say for Boko Haram, where actually fistful of money brings a lot of people in, which is not the case in the West.
I'm looking for not only predictors, but differentiated sensitivity and specificity. And I'm more concerned with catching all the problems before they happen, other than.
I would love to see some predictive values come up, and looking at the sensitivity versus specificity debate, you know, is it better to catch a few and let a few go, or to catch too many who aren't actually potentially guilty? And I don't have an answer for that, but I'd like to have some conversation on that in the future.
Lorenzo, you didn't want to go back to that? No.
No, I mean, the job's thing.
Maybe on the
30 yeah. seconds. Yeah.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Just on the jobs, I mean, if you look in the Sahel and the demographic development, and you can predict that there will be millions of youths without a job and without economic perspective. So many of them will turn to organizations. By the way, there is now more and more linkages between these terrorist groups and the organized crime. So of course they go there for $100 per month. So it's the incentive is financial. So it's clear that the perspectives play a role. I don't say that's the only driver, but that's and I think in particular in West Africa, this is a time bomb. We have to be clear about that. So, but again, you have to look then you zoom in to say exactly what are and maybe just about these programs. You always have, and that's why the roundtables are so important, and more there are roundtables where you have the police and social services and intelligence and others, because quite often in a situation you have the criminal on one side, the one who is pulling, the enablers, the organizers, the recruiters, and then you have the more vulnerable ones, the young ones who have not yet transcended this threshold. So, of course, you need this communication. And what I see now, just in the last 2 years, this has improved in Switzerland a lot. So that's completely different from the picture we had 2 years ago.
I'm going to do something which I shouldn't do. There are three women on this side that wanted to ask a question. I'll give you each 35 seconds. And we'll let the speakers answer anything that they want to. We do have a reception for everybody down on the first floor in the atrium. The lady in the front here, the lady in the blue dress, and the lady in the last, down here, I believe. Who? Yeah, very quick.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
To all the panelists, do you agree that this is Evelyn Rilin. I'm a friend of Dr. Kellerhals and a big supporter of the embassy. Of Switzerland.
I'm glad I called on you.
Institute of World Politics, actually. And do you agree that the battle is online? In this, you're looking at the demographics here. You're talking.
That's great. That's good. And the blue dress, and then in the last row, the second person in.
Also, Brevit, my name. I'm a scholar from Switzerland. I'm also from Nigeria as well. I want to know if you have thought about the role of the society in influencing people into going into terrorism, because I know quite a lot of people in Boko Haram, they are not Muslims. They are not radicals. They are just angry at the system. A system that produces such a lot of angry people should be changed. You can't just fling money around and expect the problem to go away. I think it's not a problem of money. It's a problem of anger. They are angry.
Thank you. And in the back row.
Hi, my name is Ellen Roskam. I'm a former...
Sorry?
My name is Ellen Roskam. I'm a former senior scholar from the Wilson Center. And I'm also Swiss and American. And... my question for the panel is simply, I haven't seen reported in the press in the U.S., maybe it has been, but I haven't seen it, nor have I seen even on Swiss television dialogues, something that has been presented in the Russian press, which is that ISIS, although in the West we think of them as just murderers, but it's actually a community support system in a large sense, and that there's a huge... other side to this that is also being projected in some press in some countries, that they provide services, community and social services, that the governments don't. For example, in Syria.
Thank you. Well, does anybody want to take a portion of that for a minute? any of them?
I'll take a crack at the online and I'll leave the other ones to the others. I think it's a combination of the online and offline in most cases. Again, it's very context specific. In rural Somalia, probably the internet does not play a huge role, though it does to some degree. In Western countries, it would be much larger. But again, case to case basis. I think in some cases we overstate the case of the internet. You almost think if we didn't have Facebook and Twitter, we would have no radicalization, which is obviously nonsense. If you look at just at the American cases, you do see some people at one end of the spectrum, which is basically quintessential cases of online radicalization, people who never stepped foot outside their parents' basements and met a like-minded radical individual. But then many cases it's a case where online and offline complement one another. In some cases you have a bit of sloppy journalism where somebody gets arrested, people look him up on Facebook and Twitter, so they have like 99% of us in this room have a profile online, so we're going to say, haha, online radicalization. And in many cases, it's slightly more complicated when people generally radicalize in small social circles, whether they are friends or old friends, new friends, changes from case to case, obviously, and then, like everybody else, they have also an online life, so they'll spend the evening with their friends chatting about how great ISIS is, and then we'll go home and Google how great ISIS is. Obviously, the presence on social media, and I mean, I'm not saying anything revolutionary here, has amplified the ability of ISIS to mobilize people, and that the internet plays a much larger role than in the past is one of the reasons. I think it would be too much to say it's the reason why ISIS has become so successful, one of the reasons why it has attracted larger numbers. I think we've mentioned a few other reasons on the panel earlier. And it has changed a lot of dynamics and it touches every single aspect of the radicalization process from the very beginning of it. In most cases, I would think of it very difficult, as Jutta was saying, to really know the biographies of people when they first got in touch with radical ideology. It's almost impossible to know in many cases. But what is the new dynamic? It's that it gets very operational, and you have, maybe it's a generational thing, very millennial thing, but you have a lot of people who are online, on social media, as they carry out an operation, and you saw it, for example, in Garland, Texas. You saw it in a couple of attacks in France, where people, as they are carrying out the attacks, they're tweeting, direct messaging on Twitter or talking on Facebook Live with people in Syria, or almost egging them on in how to do something. Those dynamics are extremely powerful, but I would say they amplify dynamics that would exist anyways. Al-Qaeda mobilized people in the 90s. I don't think we talked about magazine radicalization. Fax machine radicalization. So,
yeah, either of the other questions? 30 seconds?
Yeah. Yeah, I'll address the one about the Islamic State as a support system. It is correct that the Islamic State was a state, and this was largely a mechanism for control and for the extraction of taxes. So the Islamic State did set up a very elaborate way of providing electricity, but also taxing local merchants. And I would definitely not characterize this as the sort of benign welfare state that you described. On the contrary, it was a very part of the suppression mechanism that they used for controlling the local population.
And does anybody want to take on Nigeria? I think we've had a very good hour and a half. I want to thank you all. I want to thank the Swiss government and the University of Zurich for the collaboration. And I want to thank Khaled and Lorenzo and Jutta and Stefan for their comments and for coming here. It's been a very good panel. And thank you for coming to the Wilson Center. I hope you will come back. There is a reception right now down on the first floor in the hallway. And thank you again for being with us, and thanks to all the panelists.
Always, I mean, it's such a broad